The Freedom Charter is such an inspirational document that, truly speaking, in the history of humanity, it stands side by side with the Magna Carta.
I find it the richest document the ANC has ever produced, purely by virtue of the fact that it is the wishes of the people. You cannot go beyond the wishes of the people.
It is a living document, which is the vision of the movement. It remains the vision of the movement as a whole.
In my grandmother's home, we often had lots of comrades passing by. That's when I kind of heard this about this thing called the Freedom Charter, and that kind of became the refrain, how we were going to reclaim our country and how it was going to be the kind of, you know, socialist utopia.
I don't see it as a socialist document because its demands are very limited. They're just minimum demands which any social, democratic country can implement.
People use the charter to hold the ANC into account, to remind the ANC of its historic premises, but to also take us back to what the struggle against apartheid was essentially about.
It's impacted the way I sort of engaged with the space, whether it be through activism or politics, in a way that gives us personal agency. To define any norm that exists in actual space is a privilege and an honor.
I believe in any South African who seriously loves this country and is involved and thinks of it, the Freedom Charter is part of his red corpuscles.
Our forebears proclaimed in unison that, and I quote, "We, the people of South Africa, declare for all our country and the world to know that South Africa belongs to all who live in it, black and white, and that no government can justly claim authority unless it is based on the will of all the people."
During 1987, at the height of the struggle against apartheid in South Africa, COSATU held its second national congress. And by then, the ANC and the mass democratic movement reached high levels of popularity.
There is no basis at all for any cooperation between organized labor and so-called liberal bourgeoisie elements in our country. Our survival in the light of vicious repression on all fronts against the undemocratic forces leashed against us has placed us in a very central political position. We have seen that there is a growing conflict with employers as economic conditions deteriorate.
It's a period of transition, comrade, because we know we cannot move from capitalism to socialism within a night, comrade.
A debate was initiated around COSATU's political policy, central to which was whether to adopt the Freedom Charter or not. This debate pitted two dominant political tendencies within COSATU: the workerist, led by the National Union of Metal Workers of South Africa, NUMSA, and the charterist or populist, led by the National Union of Mine Workers, NUM.
We have certain principles that we as COSATU have agreed to. But most importantly, comrade, and I think we are all forgetting that, there is worker control.
The Freedom Charter is the program, a political program for the national democratic struggle.
The debate split in half one of COSATU's most militant unions, the Commercial Catering and Allied Workers Union of South Africa, CAWUSA.
It is no good for us to adopt the Freedom Charter, only to be able to stand on a soapbox on a street corner and say, I adopted the charter.
The workerists had socialist leanings and were wary of the liberation movement and the ANC, which were still banned and in exile. COSATU needed to have a close alliance with the ANC in the struggle against apartheid.
It is quite a sensitive subject we are dealing with now, because it's determining the future of this federation.
The COSATU 1987 debate around the Freedom Charter was not about serious differences about the content of the charter, but whether to ally COSATU closely with the ANC or not.
We say we are a federation that is controlled by workers.
It is for this reason that the majority of workers in COSATU have adopted the Freedom Charter.
When the Nets took over after 1945, 48 was their first election and they went through. The move of the regime became more and more tough and became clear on the cards that the Communist Party was going to be outlawed. So they started the Congress movement. The whites worked among the white community to influence them, because the whites, many of them were better than we were, according to the law.
The decision to establish and run the Congress of Democrats was mainly strategic. You know, there were places we couldn't go, things we couldn't do, and it enabled us to contribute as the support troops to identify with the Congress movement as it became.
The coloureds had to be brought up to the point to make them realise that stand together and oppose the regime. The Indians were the same way, and we all worked under the banner of the African National Congress.
In 1952, the ANC launched the defiance campaign of protest and deliberately defying the new apartheid laws en masse.
The ANC became a mass movement with the defiance campaign. And the defiance campaign was a huge success. It was a huge mobilization. No one could have predicted that, what is it, 8,000 people would go to jail voluntarily. And no one would have thought that the ANC, which was cloaked in respectability, you know, Professor Matthews or Chief Lutuli, these were people of dignity. No one could think that they would lead a prison campaign, stand up in public and say, I'm going to defy the law. So there was a sea change in the leadership, in their commitment, and this led to a sea change among the masses. In that process, a mass movement emerged.
I came home every day at a certain time from work. But on a Tuesday and a Thursday, I went to meetings to learn how to become really radical. Not using guns, using the brains, talking to people, making them realize how to bring about the change with this vicious system.
I became a full-time cadre of the Congress of the People. I was an organizer. And I worked with Greenberg Gajana. And the two of us were organizers, and we used to go to Langa and Stellenbosch and Worcester and Paar, all over the place, to the townships, to hold public meetings. So it was very hazardous. The police were after us all the time. The special branch were very active, and we were always scared because we knew what was coming, and it came. It was knife-edge stuff.
The apartheid regime's brutal repression of the defiance campaign led to the Congress Alliance calling for the convening of the Congress of the People.
In Cape Town, Brian Bunting, Governor Mbeki, ran the propaganda campaign, organized the leaflets.
A call to the people was produced, a beautiful document, and we went to all the townships and we had public meetings, and at all these meetings we called for demands.
All the people who were Congressites then went out to the various people and areas and met people in the street and organizations wanting, finding out, what would you like to have done in our country one day?
What do you want? What do you want out of a new society? What do you want in a new South Africa?
And they went throughout the whole country, of course. And everybody, as far as and wide as they could, everybody they met to say their piece as to what they wanted. And they wrote it on cardboard and bits of paper and toilet paper.
We want a tarred road. We want streetlights. We want a lavatory. We want the boss, not to talk to us like the way he talks to us at the factory. It wasn't as if the basis, the background of the demands was everybody was thinking of tremendously high politics. Yes, of course there were people like that. That was the whole basis behind them kind of organizing the campaign. But the people who were actually involved was the guy who's emptying the rubbish bin there now. To the best of my knowledge, amongst the white community, complete and total indifference, if anything else, no worse, active hostility, let's be honest about it. And while I certainly wasn't part of the drafting of the Freedom Charter, I absolutely do believe the people who told me that they sat around in a room with these heaps and these paper and tried to cull them into sense. To me, the Freedom Charter is poetry.
And then, of course, came the Congress itself, where there were 3,000 participants, with another 10,000 or so standing outside the venue.
We got together and decided we wanted to go to Kliptown.
60 years ago, 3,000 men and women from all walks of life, from towns, villages, and the rural hinterland, young and old, rich and poor, workers, peasants, and intellectuals descended on this place, Kliptown, where we are gathered today. The delegates to that august occasion, the Congress of the People, longed for a country and continent where all shall live as equal, with equal opportunities, friendship, and brotherhood. These patriots, defying all odds, including harassment, intimidation, detention, and beatings, gathered here, driven by nothing else but their love for their country and the quest for freedom.
Many more people than us tried to get from Cape Town to Kliptown, but they didn't make it.
Alex was on his way with a few others and by lorry to Kliptown. In Beaufort West, they were arrested. And that is where they spent their days of the conference that was held in Kliptown and never reached it.
I was a safe, secure white. I was a university student and I was protected as a university student. That must be distinguished very, very thoroughly from what it was like from the 60s onwards. It was frightening sometimes, stressing sometimes, but it was almost a game parking your car a long way away so that you could walk to a place and you knew the special branch were going to take numbers. Yes, we knew ANC people, and we knew that they were having a bitter time.
There are 3,000 people sitting on planks, on bricks, on a hill. And on the side, these ladies from the Indian Congress set up two tables, and they had big signs, soup with meat and soup without meat, because they were vegetarians. And we used to joke during the treason trial about, are we getting soup with meat or soup without meat? You know, there was a hell of an atmosphere. Partly because it was a unique gathering. It was the biggest public meeting we had ever had in South Africa, a non-racial basis. It was largely African, but there were quite a lot of whites and Indians and coloureds there, quite a lot.
There was a platform in front. The platform was actually quite high. The chair changed from section to section of the Freedom Charter, and then speakers would come forward from the floor of the Congress, of the people, to speak to the clauses of the Freedom Charter.
I had the economic clause, and I remember Sonia Bunting spoke about peace.
I don't recall any of the well-known names being there, although I think there were messages from them. We were very conscious of banning orders. They were hurtful, they made us angry. They made me angry. But in a funny sort of a way, naively, I regarded them as a kind of accolade. You are worth banning.
So what they did is they got a flat not far away, and they sat in this flat and looked through the window at the meeting, because they were very jealous of our wonderful meeting, you see. So none of them could attend.
We were standing in a small group, me, Tony Anderson, Benny Sachs, and probably Wilson Wadi would have been there, and probably Alf Wannenberg. And the message came from the platform, we need to have somebody who's going to introduce the doors of learning and culture shall be opened. Benny was our leader, he was our unofficial leader. And he said, right, we've got to produce a speaker. You've never spoken at a public meeting before, Merton, you do it. And I was absolutely startled. And I found a piece of paper, and I remember folding it into quarters, and I wrote some notes on it. And I went onto the platform with my little bit of paper. And I must confess, I remember what I said to this day. I've never told anybody else about it. And I would very much prefer it to be forgotten. It was so inappropriate and it was such rubbish.
Whenever they adopted the clause of the Freedom Charter, every time they'll say, Maibuye, all power, aluta.
What created a lot of tension was the police, because there was a posse of police on horseback outside the fence, and they just rode around instead of being visible. And there were all sorts of police standing there with guns, and there were armored police vehicles. And they were, of course, taking notes of all the speeches, because we were speaking from the platform, which they used later on in the treason trial. A posse of police came walking in. And in those days, the police used Sten guns. And a Sten gun has a barrel, and they were clicking the barrel and went tick 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 tick. And as they came walking in, they were doing this, you see, and we could hear something was going on.
And I found myself sitting next to a man, and he said to me, "You're frightened, aren't you?" And I said, "Yes." And he said, "Give me your hands." And he said, "I'm used to the police. This has happened to me before. I'm not frightened." And he took my hand and said, "And you're not frightened." I wasn't. That was the spirit in the Congress of the people.
These are men and women who dared to dream. They dreamt of a country free of oppression. They dreamt of a country free of economic exploitation. They also dreamt of a country that is prosperous and at peace with itself and the world.
The whole audience rose, and I thought they were going to rush the police. It was so close. They were so angry, because this meeting was something very special.
Where are all your kids? Are they home? Are they watching you do this? Are they watching you fight against us?
People were angry. People were hurt. I think that while on the one hand it was inevitable and it was necessary tactically from their point of view that the regime had to break it up and get involved like that, by God, it didn't do them any good.
And everybody knew it was a piece of history, and the police were disrupting it. And somebody started singing Unzi Malum Twalo, "The Burden is Heavy." Slowly, the audience began to sing Unzi Malum Twalo, and it calmed down, and then people sat down. So, a very dangerous, because the police were ready to open fire. And if they'd opened fire, it would have been from outside as well as from inside. They walked in and got up on the platform where the speakers were sitting, and they said to the chairman, "This meeting is closed." So he said, "Okay, can I close the meeting?" They said, "Okay." So he got up, And he said, police are asking me to close the meeting. So I want to ask you, do you approve of the Freedom Charter? And we all said, yes, we adopted the charter. He said, the charter is adopted and the meeting is closed. So they closed the gate and they set up tables at the gate, and every delegate was searched, name and address taken, place of work and so on. And of course the police followed up and nearly everybody was fired, those who had jobs. And then came the treason trial. So 156 of us were arrested.
The treason trial came as a result of the Kliptown Conference. Of course, they realized what was really on. We were making a move to overthrow the government. A very strong move. So then they had this treason trial, which lasted for 4 years. But it was squashed after 4 years. It was squashed because the evidence wasn't there.
There are things I want to say about the way in which the Constitution has been disregarded and being violated by the ANC, which I am a member. I used to be so proud of it. And I was so proud of the Constitution which we were drawing up.
Discussion and negotiations and compromises, common solutions can actually be found. Yes, it's a challenge, but I wouldn't call it a crisis, because we do have ways and means of discussing the matter.
Do we still have a crisis in education? Definitely.
There's a big crisis. In fact, it's a catastrophe.
There's vast inequality in the country, right? In the spaces where the working class community lives, those people are getting poorer, but the education system is also getting poorer in those areas. Not enough resources are being able to reach those areas, whether it's a textbook, a desk, a window for a school. And then when you look at middle-class schools, or when you go into the southern suburbs of Cape Town, for example, there's vast differences in the way learners are able to engage with curriculum and the schooling system in general.
Probably have a mate in the house, have access to the latest gadgets. Those learners are even able to teach their teachers before they can actually be taught how to operate things like computers and computer literacy classes.
We have a two-tier basic education system. There's one for the rich, and then the one for the masses and the working class. And I think for me that is meant to produce a layer of those who are going to work for the rich. As laborers.
The overwhelming majority of black kids are trapped in a dysfunctional, poor education system that was reserved to reproduce the cheap labor system in the Pakistans and in the townships. In that world, 50% of the kids do not arrive at grade 12 in the prescribed 12 years. There is a massive dropout rate, which nobody have done a proper research to find out exactly why, and more so why so many drop out at grade 10 and 11.
Government has not done enough to make sure that children all across the country have schools that are able to teach them and help them become better serving citizens in the economy.
We are said to be one of the biggest spenders on education in the world, certainly in middle-income countries. But we have the worst record in maths and science. We have a huge dropout rate. And all that is symptomatic of a poor functioning education system.
There are issues like, you know, lack of transport, uniform, children who don't have access to food as their parents are unemployed.
The number of children in school is now comparable with almost anywhere in the world. But the education is poor, the teachers are poor, and the quality of the equipment is hopeless.
The schools are there, but they don't achieve anything real because it's difficult to learn and teach in these spaces.
There are a lot of kids that work at a slower pace, and the fact that we have such big numbers, we're not able to do more the way we'd like to if we had a smaller group.
And half of the time it is not in the home language, which makes it hard. So we teach at a slower pace than what a more privileged school would be able to. The schools here are not equipped. We're just given the basic things, and we use our money that comes out of our pockets half of the time.
Recently, we went on a learning visit to the Eastern Cape, and we visited 60 schools, and we found that just about 46 of the 60 schools that we visited had at least one building made of inappropriate structure. And when you say at least one, this is like at most minimum. So typically schools are still made of mud structures or just plain of wood or just of asbestos.
So you see, the figures can be manipulated to show success. On the one hand, the numbers are going to school. On the other hand, when you look at the facilities and the administration, it's pretty awful.
There's so many strikes that are going on around the country, even at basic education level, where recently we had students in Alice block out a road in the Eastern Cape and protest because they didn't have sufficient classrooms, and it had been a problem for a while. You've got school in the more urban areas of the country, in Cape Town and Johannesburg, typically on the streets, saying to government, enough is enough. These are young learners, you know. They haven't probably even rationalized to themselves the power of using your body as a political instrument. But they've been pushed to those levels because the education system is in dismay. It truly is in crisis. And the ANC has not done enough.
Education constitutes the center for development in South Africa and in Africa. The sustainability of political freedom and the economic freedom depends on the education.
The principles which we fought for in 1976, if we look back the history of our struggle and see where they originated, we can see clearly that they originated in the Freedom Charter, because the Freedom Charter rejects the Bantustans. It talks about freedom of education, where it originated in the Freedom Charter, but are now being carried on by people who may consciously or not consciously be aware that they are taking those ideas from the Freedom Charter.
The most reactionary institutions in South Africa, like universities, are beginning to listen.
We demand that UCT call an emergency council meeting to discuss the immediate suspension of the fee increase of 10.8%.
Yeah. Fees must fall. We've betrayed them. Basically, they looked up to us. All we have done is just allowed the whites to continue with their privilege. And what you're asking us to do is, let's just accept it. And our parents are no different from when they were liberated, or whatever you call it. Therefore, let's change the terminology. We'll decolonize the country, and we'll start with you, and decolonize you. So I thought, wow.
I think the phrase decolonizing the universe is a very important phrase. I think we've got to decolonize society in the sense of allow it to escape from the shackles of a very horrible past.
Those kids who demand free education, they are demanding the implementation of the Freedom Charter. Those who say, let's share in the wealth of the country, they are demanding the implementation of the Freedom Charter.
The struggle continues. The struggle of the black child continues, but now it has taken a financial form. And when we continue to get financially excluded, that then becomes the way in which we are inhibited and we are marginalized from achieving the full potential of this country.
You now have to buy education. If you don't have money, you're coming from a working class and poor background, you're most likely not to be able, after you've exited high school, to enter institutions of higher learning.
The majority of our people are poor. If you look at the dynamics of society, where you have almost 50% of the working people living with less than 10 rand a day, how do you then expect them to have exorbitant amounts of 5,000 to 10,000 registration at the end of the year? And tuition and residence and accommodation and catering and food costs that will amount to almost 60,000 to 70,000 anyway. It's impossible.
And I think what we've experienced this year is the equivalent of 1976 to our current government.
He wants to be able to say in the media that there was a small group of hooligans that needed to be arrested. So we must show that there are hundreds of hooligans.
It's a challenge from below to say this is not the way we want to live.
You see, people shall govern and they should be represented in all race and everything else, but we also know that there hasn't been much information in terms of academic staffing. You go to the statutory committees of these institutions, most of them, it's white males that are sitting there and dominating them. There's no gender diversity. Even though we speak of equity, Equity Act and everything else, we still haven't seen transformation in that. Our roots must fall. Where basically students were saying, let us decolonize education. Starting the statues, but also not just the statues themselves, but what they represented.
This charter here talks about access to education. This is what the youth are fighting for, that you did promise that we will access education, so now we want delivery. Education is not a privilege, it is a right.
Education is a service to Africa. We are tired of education being seen as a commodity, and we would like education to rather be seen as a service that it should be.
Higher education is important for the future. They're not doing anybody a favor by studying.
I feel that we have been mandated to come and get our qualifications so that we can go back to our communities and give back to those children and make sure that they also come back here in the higher learning institutions and achieve what they want to become.
I cannot come to any other conclusion but that we are dealing here not with a spontaneous outburst, but with a deliberate attempt to bring about polarization between whites and blacks.
In fact, often those who are calling for have free higher education for their ulterior motives. Their ulterior motives is actually to destabilize government, you know, and to mislead students for their own narrow political agendas.
This government will not be intimidated, and instructions have been given to maintain law and order at all costs. Those educational institutions at which blacks are destroying their own amenities will be closed for an indefinite period.
If you say free education for all, there must be an ulterior motive. Why should I be paid for by a government?
People have the idea that the government will now hesitate to act. They are making a mistake.
Indeed, the malaise lies at the heart of the universities and at the heart of government, a snail pace changing of society through the lens of universities and producing new intellectuals and new skills. And we, all students are seemingly now agreeing.
The defining factor of Fees Must Fall is that it has not been something that has been specific to any political organizations. Yeah. It has been a movement that has been owned and driven entirely by students.
There can never be a real empowerment in any country until you address the question of education.
Happy!
Since the 19th century, South Africa has had a highly monopolized racial system of industrial capitalism, with ownership and control of the economy dominated by what is referred to as white monopoly capital. Made up of big South African capitalists and foreign investors, the colonial rulers and later the apartheid government designed the system to perpetuate cheap black labor needed by mining and agricultural companies. During the early years of the Mandela presidency, the ANC government favored economic policies that promised to address apartheid's legacy of huge inequality and widespread poverty.
What we want to achieve is a healthy and vibrant economy which can ensure full employment to our people, maximum production, and the development of social justice. We wanted to rectify the imbalances that exist in our economy.
But this soon changed in 1996, with the government adopting the neoliberal growth, employment, and redistribution or GEA policy.
Sharing in the country's wealth pre-1994, it represented a promise, something that we were all working towards. Even though we were young, it's something that we thought, okay, when the new government comes, we are going to really share, not just people voting, but actually sharing the wealth, the resources.
The mineral wealth beneath the soil, the monopoly banks shall be transferred to the ownership of the people as a whole. Big industrial corporations shall be managed for the benefit of the people as a whole. That's the core of the working class issues.
When we speak about the people and restoring the wealth of the people, we're talking about the redistribution of wealth to the majority, people who simply do not make enough to eke out a living.
What we have seen post-94, instead of like the kind of redistribution that the Freedom Charter, more modest measure, our constitution envisioned, is not what has happened.
Despite major redistributive efforts since the democratic breakthrough of 1994, the triple crisis of unemployment, poverty, and inequality persists. In some respects, it has worsened.
For the mine workers, this sharing of the wealth is really just something that's on paper. There hasn't been anything that has significantly changed since 1994.
Statistics South Africa, most recent data indicate that in the first quarter of 2017, a further 48,000 jobs were lost, adding to the 9 million unemployed. And the unemployment rate among youth is at catastrophic levels.
Our people, especially the working class and the poor, are confronted with the crisis of poverty, unemployment, and inequality. As a result of the ANC insistence on implementing neoliberal economic policies, we're also experiencing the impact of having our credit rating downgraded to junk status, and the negative impact this has had on the growth outlook of the economy.
Neoliberal economic policies are measures implemented by the governments and capitalists to shift the burden of economic crises onto the backs of poor and middle-class people. They include cuts in social spending, privatization of public goods and services, increases in the price of education, water, electricity, public transport, and so on.
We needed to have adopted a macroeconomic framework that would not produce the kinds of extreme inequality that South Africa is characterized today from.
South Africa is notorious for being the most unequal society in terms of income inequality. A recent Deloitte survey of CEOs and chief financial officers at the top 100 JSE listed companies found that on average, they were getting a total pay package of 17.9 million rands a year, or about 69,000 rands a day.
On that score alone, there has not been any aggressive implementation of the Freedom Charter. Otherwise, those figures would not be saying so.
Since the discovery of minerals in our country, mining bosses have chased profit based on availability of the cheap and unskilled labor.
Before 1994, there were enormous pressures on the leadership of the ANC to make big concessions on the economy. On politics, the regime was willing to agree that there has to be some transfer of power. And in all the discussions in exile with Thabo Mbeki and others, the economy was put aside. But nevertheless, we went ahead and we drew up the Reconstruction and Development Program, the RDP. But behind the scenes, the IMF and World Bank and Bretton Woods institutions were putting enormous pressure on Thabo Mbeki and on the government to modify that because it was too progressive for them. And so in 1996, GEAR came into existence. And GEAR was a very, very nasty program. A degree of austerity was introduced, which meant cutting back on the state, cutting back on spending. But that set the scene. We have been following a policy of fiscal prudence all along, even now. This is what led to lack of fulfillment and achievement in many of the clauses of the Charter.
In a profit-led economy model, this wage system is an anchor for monopoly capital and the root of the exploitation of workers.
While poverty and insecurity are the daily bread of the majority, a tiny capitalist elite live with excessive wealth.
The relationship between the ANC and monopoly capital in particular, but also capital in general, is one of unity and struggle, or if you like, cooperation and contestation.
Even the second decade of democracy have benefited in economic terms more white monopoly capital and not the motive forces of the revolution.
Capital has no color. Capitalists have a color. We do not deny that the majority of capitalists in South Africa are white.
The state capture, a lot of people think that the state capture is something that they've just arisen now with Gupta. No. There's a bigger capture of the ANC by capital.
The issue is the reason we love Nelson Mandela is because he made a deal with the white elites, the power structures, the De Beers, the Oppenheimers, to remain in power, and he wouldn't touch their wealth.
That structure of the economy have not been unbundled, have not been undone. It remains intact today, and that's why we are seeing more unemployment, poverty, inequality crisis, precisely because we've not done the basics.
So you've been in power for more than 20 years, and you failed to deliver on the economic and some of the social promises that you've made. And what better way to basically make the case for you staying on than to actually point at white monopoly capital and all of that, as if you didn't have the state power and the electoral majority to change the conditions of the people?
That's why we also find this concept of white monopoly capital quite strange. Because it's as if we have got black monopoly capital, then South Africa will be liberated.
Unless you actually address the fact that the laws of South Africa doesn't make the corporations share the wealth as the Freedom Charter demands, my fear is nothing will change.
it has become now very, very clear that the government, led by the ANC, have abandoned any notion of a radical and progressive developmental path.
The phenomenon of monopoly capital is a global one, and it manifests itself differently in various parts of the globe. And in that context, it would therefore not be correct to characterize ours simply as white monopoly capital.
With policies like BEE, it was sort of turned to mean that, well, black incorporation basically into the regime of accumulation, and that's not what the Freedom Charter intended. And there are a lot of people who share this particular view.
The majority of people are basically kind of living off of the crumbs of, you know, shareholders and monopoly capitalists. And a few rich black elites have accumulated in the post-94 economic dispensation.
What BEE has done is to entrench, actually, the link between black capitalist class and the old class that ruled before 1994.
You have a state that's largely captured by economic elites who are advancing to a large extent, you know, a pro-capitalist agenda that's about getting as much out of the economic cake for them and their connected few.
It must be remembered that it was the mining industry, and specifically the Chamber of Mines, which pioneered the most oppressive features of apartheid South Africa.
For workers in mining, not just subcontracted workers, but workers in general, in terms of, have they seen that wealth? Has that wealth been redistributed? Are they sharing it in any way? And the answer for them is no, and their lived experiences spell out the no.
This test that we're going through, which incidentally I think continues to have many positive potential future outcomes, is precisely a way where liberal business is trying to find a sustainable pattern of sharing power with black workers. A pattern of sharing power that does justice to economic reality and that is fair in terms of everybody's interests.
I don't know how one shares power with people who've got shotguns in their hands, who've got tear gas canisters, and I don't know how one shares power with people who are paying the starvation wages that they pay.
The figure of Cyril Ramaphosa, who started out in the union movement, was the general secretary of the NUM, moved on to the ANC, led the ANC at its apex and left and went to business.
Sharing of the wealth in the country means workers being paid decent wages. For women, it's not a reflection of an industry or wealth that is being equally shared. The fact that in mining, wages until 2012 had not risen substantially for a very long time. And for them, even after 2012, yes, there's been changes in terms of what people are taking home, but it's not a massive change when you think about how much wealth these people are producing in a way.
You've got these workers who are largely black, who are extracting this wealth, and their economic position has not changed. And they extract this wealth and it gets shipped off, you know, overseas.
Black people who get into white-owned companies through the black economic empowerment process then get into a system, one, which is very reluctant to change, and two, which they don't own completely and which they don't control. So at best, what they do, or what we do, is to be advocates.
There's no such thing as a liberal bourgeois. They are all the same. They use fascist methods to destroy workers' lives.
What's significant about Ramaphosa is the Marikana moment in 2012. At the critical moment before the massacre, Ramaphosa basically chose where he stands, or on which side of the fence he stands, and it was with Lonmin, which is international capital.
For many, the Marikana massacre of 34 striking Lonmin mine workers on 16 August 2012 represents a political turning point in post-apartheid South Africa. It brutally laid bare the common interests of the ruling party and white monopoly capital, and conversely, the new dispensation being against the black working class.
If there is an issue that has preoccupied our people greatly since 1994, it has been the question of land.
They don't even understand what they're talking about when they talk about land and food security. If they understood and actually understand the dynamics on the ground and condone the lives of those that are struggling and not pretend, because if they think they will do it with debt, that is not. It won't.
Since the 17th century, indigenous black people were robbed of their land through colonial conquests. This continued well into the 20th century with wars of dispossession, replaced by laws of dispossession, such as the 1913 Land Act, which prescribed that Africans could only occupy and own land in reserve areas, which made up a mere 13% of all land in South Africa.
Nowhere for me is the bankruptcy of the Freedom Charter more clearly demonstrated than on the land question.
The issue of land redistribution is probably the biggest failure of the ANC post-1994, the biggest failure of the democratic government.
Is there anybody who actually sit and reflect about the land issue? They should have done it a long time ago.
If we say the land should be shared and the people who will work the land will also own the land, I think this is just a myth.
We find ourselves that the land question is far from resolved. Oppression, exploitation, violence is rife in the rural areas.
The government have long ago forgot about us as landless people, as especially the women. The policies of land is just to ensure that the capitalist system are growing, and there's no pro-poor policy.
Long live all South Africans, long live.
Long live!
Long live the freedom that Mandela fought for, long live.
Long live!
The government have been implementing for 20 years a program of sharing the land with farm workers, namely the government's land reform program. Farm workers mainly get to share in the land through what is called equity schemes, where they get shares in the farming business.
Soos as weet dat die meengewone belang behoort aan die gemeenskap en ons hier die gewoon by die munisipaliteit, hulle bestuur dit namens die gemeenskap.
But even the way people think about land redistribution, they basically thinking about replacing a black white farmer with a black farmer, so a big land baron with another big land baron who still engages in exploitation. There's no question about what social relations will prevail on those particular farms and how you can actually include communities in that scheme. It's an elite-driven project.
Where there's communal land, where the chiefs have the right to the land and the custodianship of the land, it's always when women go to ask for land, where's your husband? Your marital status are connected to access to land for women.
The redistribution process has failed. The willing buyer, willing seller policy, this linking it to market prices actually resulted in government spending so much money and buying some of these farms far more than they're worth.
I maintain that we've been paying too much of a premium for land that should have been expropriated in the interests of the public.
The Freedom Charter was saying, occupy the land wherever you choose to occupy the land. It's not Malema, it's the Freedom Charter.
The land should be shared amongst those who work it.
Land redistribution must be accompanied by other measures if we are to achieve the goal at the required pace. expropriation without compensation within the law, within the constitution.
Government, in the public interest, has the right to take land, to expropriate land for public use and for public interest use. And in doing so, it can then determine the price on which it expropriates that land.
This year will mark the fifth anniversary of the farm workers' strike, and there were critical lessons emerging from that particular strike about organizing, but there was also a big reminder about how little things have changed. Look at the condition of farm workers in South Africa today, and you juxtapose it to the condition of farm workers under apartheid, and you'll see that there's very little that has changed.
It's in geen verskil. Dat mensen wordt nog steeds slecht behandeld op plaatsen. Dat is nog bij je uitzettings wat plaatsvindt op plaatsen.
Ik heb het maar net van de plaatsen was het.
Law enforcement was evict us.
Kom brekelen met dieren open. Daar mij goed uit.
Shooting us with rubber bullets, with tear gas.
Dus hoe ik kan werken? Dus zet hem het nou voor mij af.
We have families, we have kids.
My man was on the plaza for sitting to me. They put my hand.
And I beat your hand on me to hand.
During the time that the extension of Security of Tenure Act, there's been 2.4 million people at least evicted from farms in South Africa.
I had the bangers for 20 years. The poor had said, if my house is leeg, make the poor for the house for the verdiende gee wat by hom in die kombuis werk. Toen zei ik voor die boer, maar ik ga niet uit die. Toen zei de procureur, oké, als Ossie wil uitgaan, dan moet Os maar hof toe gaan. Os is van 2000 af, 2001. Dus Os van die plaats af afgezet. Hij had nog niet die oom uitgebetaald, nog die oom zijn geld gegeven.
Onze mensen, de meeste van die kennen hun rechten niet en ze bewegen niet uit die plaatsen zonder om rechten stappen te volgen. Om zonder om even een hofbevel te krijgen, want hij is nog bang voor die boer.
Employers find various ways of evading legislation.
Die mensen wat amper 10 jaar gaan op die plaats blijven, dat is die mensen wat die boeren zo slecht behandelen. Omdat hij weet, zodra die persoon voor 10 jaar daar blijft, dan wordt die persoon geprotect die eerste law.
The solution can't be to share between workers and capitalists, between blacks and racist farmers. It's never going to work. The solution is to do away with the share that capitalists have in the land.
Op die oomblik is die ANC as regering is die mandaat nie daar om arme mense se kwessies aan te spreek nie.
What seems to be happening is that it's acceleration of urbanization rather than distribution of land. And urbanization means small little pockets of land holdings with a lot of credit of buildings and then expensive buildings and so on, and then that is development. For me, that is not the solution. That's we're building on a crisis that when it explodes, you will be shocked. You are nursing a crisis. You are not conforming to the Freedom Charter.
I think one of the things that we did miss out on is actually demanding a complete reversal of all of those gains that apartheid had for the privileged. And that would have meant the immediate return of the land that had been taken forcefully from its owners.
Ons wil nie sien dat daar 'n tweede Zimbabwe gebeur nie, maar volgens wat dit nou gaan, dat die rykdom by 'n paar mense sit en die rykdom nie verdeel word onder die arme mense nie, sal ons in die toekoms met dieselfde geval sit wat Zimbabwe mee gesit word, as dit al manier is om gewoon in ons mense se hande te kry.
You have to break the power of the racist capitalist farmers. And to do that, you have to take away their property. They have wealth. That is the source of their power. Those things must be taken away.
Do you think the current ANC government is willing and able to solve the land question?
ek trek uit Mitsasplein uit en gaan bly in Blikkiesdorp en gaan hoekom moet ons hier uit en om in die wagtens daar vrede te stel.
I grew up in a family where the Freedom Charter was almost of biblical proportions.
Hulle slaap blikke elke aan. As het rien, ons keer water uit ons hokke uit, man. Hy gee nie vir ons wat ons wil hê, ons moet gee nie. Hy is te geriefelik agter oor.
When I became minister, I looked at that section that dealt with housing. There shall be no slums. There shall be no fenced environment for people. There will be crèches and all of those things where people live. That defines what we now call human settlements.
Ons braai mense kry niks reg nie. As die African man nou gesê het, ons gaan daar gaan. As jy net 'n paar mense wat gaan nie. Hulle is daar duisende wat gaan daar gaan. En hulle gaan toi toi en hulle gaan slaap heel week voor die parlement se huis. Dan kry hulle reg. Hoe kan ons braai mense dan nie daar reken nie?
There isn't a country that has provided its citizens with as many housing opportunities as this country. We have provided 4 million housing and housing opportunities for our people.
I lived in this place, Mizamo Yetu, from 1991. We have about 33,000 residents, which 80% of it is young people. Before, we lived in the bushes of Hau Bay. When they remove us from one bush, we go around like dasis to another bush. We circle the whole bay bushes. That's why we are here for all those years. And in 1990, we had a big fire, and when we lost 4 lives, and others were critically burned, is when the people were removed from Siprodak's bush to this land. They were supplied with 4 sheets and plastic and poles to build the houses. 1993, they started to make some streets, and we thought they would build some houses, but it didn't. Came like they just built some toilets. And all those years we have been waiting for the government to build some houses. The struggle goes on.
The Freedom Charter says there shall be houses, security and comfort.
Our government says he'll build house RDP, enough RDP for the people. But today, there is nothing like that.
The question is, do people have houses, security and comfort? I think not.
When we got into government in 1994, inheriting all the red tape that we found in government, we realized that between what we want to do and what is possible is a chasm.
Since 1994, when the ANC government adopted the RDP, Reconstruction and Development Program, it committed itself to spending at least 5% of the national budget on housing. Has never done so.
When Joe Slovo started the program on housing, the budget to deal with that was not going to be able to cover everybody that needed housing.
Do you get the smell?
Ordinary working class people, they say these houses are worse than apartheid's matchbox houses. You know, it's just a hall without partitions inside. Many of them are built with flimsy material. There are cracks, falling down, roof leaks.
Africa is one of the most rapidly urbanizing continents, and South Africa probably very close to the top of that. The pull factor is the search for jobs.
People from rural areas, they come in the hope that it's where I can get a job. No job, no place to stay. So the best is to build this little mkuku for me.
And we cannot match the influx into the urban areas. And unfortunately for us, the backlog grows faster than we are able to build. When you see the site of these shacks and the numbers of these shacks, you do come to the conclusion that we are in crisis.
More than 5 million people live in informal settlements, if we include backyard shacks and also standalone shacks.
We recognize that we have a great deal of inherited poverty, but we also have able-bodied young people who can get themselves out of poverty.
We live in a community where there's shortage of space. I think it's important that young people are also awarded the opportunity to qualify for houses, especially young people who are post-matric, as well as people who have been through tertiary education. Simply because our background, it actually disables a lot of young people an opportunity to actually obtain a house.
The 20-year-old, he's been in that shack from birth up to 20 years. Now he said, no, it's too much, I cannot live in that. Then he started to build another mkuku.
I am dealing with 100-year-old people who don't have houses. Just culturally, it is unheard of that I would prioritize you over somebody who is that old.
The ANC has tended to allow business methods and logic to intrude into housing. So you find that cement factories, brick factories, even the people who actually build the houses, the companies, they're all doing it for profit.
We announced that we, as government, have something like 55 mega catalytic projects. We opened this matter up to the private sector to say the private sector is free to come and join us.
If you put out tenders, you spend on the tendering process, someone, you know, wins the tender and then they cut corners, let alone the corruption. So a lot of money meant for houses ends up in private pockets in various ways at every point of the chain, the supply chain and the building chain.
The mass low-cost RDP and other subsidized housing programs have had the unintended consequence of entrenching apartheid special patterns by building working-class housing in peripheral locations far from work and other resources. And this has served simply to reproduce working-class marginalization and black poverty.
Since 1994, the private sector in the bigger municipalities has constructed 1,625,000 residential buildings financed by the big commercial banks.
The only way to build a house is to go to the bank, but you have to qualify. So in a way, the provision of housing and the major decisions are being outsourced to the banks, you know, to the money lenders, and this is a problem.
Because we are dealing with capitalists in this country, the money first, profit first, and the people come after. So the poor person, man or woman, he'll be evicted or she'll be evicted in that house. They'll send the Red Ants, they'll send the police, and yet we know if they evict you, they should give you a space or a place to stay. As our Freedom Chart says.
I used to stay in RNS for 14 years now. Today I'm homeless, I've got nothing to eat, I'm at the street and I'm going to sleep here with a baby. The baby doesn't even wearing anything. I don't know what to do.
The law that we are dealing with, which is the protection of illegal eviction, is one that says that you may not evict anybody without first making sure that you provide, there is a house provided.
Over the last 20 years, those at the bottom have been systematically impoverished. More than 2 million farm workers have been evicted during this period.
We've been evicted without letting us know. We don't know why we have been evicted.
There was an oversight when we created the law, but unfortunately the courts have tended to be on the side of the landlord.
Since the 1990s, more people have been evicted than under the Group Areas Act.
20 years past,
democracy, it is still the same status quo. What is the land movement about?
What we need to do is restructure how we think about the provision of housing for our people.
The housing should be included as part of integration and transformation, because we are just a main road that divides us from the haves and have-nots.
The national sound for South Africa should be a thunder of bulldozers and diggers. If you go past the townships, it should be forests of tower cranes, thundering big trucks bringing in bricks, concrete, cement. Dignity being brought to people. And there are men by the side of the road.
The Freedom Charter has been most influential in the new South Africa's democratic rights, as contained in the country's constitution and Bill of Rights. However, the reality of South Africa's political economy has undermined these rights for the majority.
When we say the people shall govern, it means that rather than having a top-down approach, we should have this participatory process, because that's the lesson really of the Congress of the People when they were asked what kind of South Africa would they want to live in. Their answers is what, you know, gave birth to the Freedom Charter.
In one sense, people are governing. We are now supposedly a democracy. We get to vote every now and then.
We only visit our people once in 5 years when we are going for elections.
Once they are voted into power, they tend to shift focus or forget about their core promises.
There are serious concerns about where we're going. And those concerns relate very much to the functioning of government.
Before the elections, it is presented that it is you are choosing the leaders to represent your needs. But once they are there, they forget about the people.
The first phase of our national democratic revolution, which had promised so much, is now under threat of erosion and reversal.
Our degrees cost more than the sheikhs we live in. As I'm standing here, my first degree cost 300,000. My mother does not even own a home which cost 300,000. Students,
Oh my God! Oh my God!
If you look on the right to protest, we've seen how a number of times those who are in power respond to protest.
Marikana and the farm worker rebellion of 2012 were really important moments and to a large extent major points of departure in the contract between state and citizens.
Things are slipping, they are. If you go to Parliament, you will see that many members of Parliament don't know the Freedom Charter.
What was most disturbing about Marikana was to see the collusion of some of South Africa's ruling elites and the kind of clear statement of a state that will defend corporate interests even to the point of actually murdering people.
No government that justly claims authority should ever turn its guns on its own people.
We thought that those were the things that, you know, the apartheid government did because they were bad and horrible. But for, you know, a democratic government to have murdered workers demanding a living wage instead of playing some role that facilitated and advanced, you know, workers' demands.
We are not part of a country that kills our people. We are not part of a country where the land and the minerals belong to white people. We are not part of that arrangement. We reject South Africa.
Andries Dadane was shot and killed for protesting for water. And access to water is a basic need. People need water. So why would you want to kill someone for that?
Once that happens, it means that there is a major, major deviation from the tenets of the Freedom Charter, because a government that is inspired by the Freedom Charter should really lend a sympathetic ear to those demands.
We are in a tricky situation where things could deteriorate and could deteriorate quickly.
Much, but not all of this popular decline is related to the almost daily revelation of, I must say, embarrassing scandals involving highly placed ANC politicians in government, and particularly those who have been entangled with the notorious Gupta Empire.
All shall be equal before the law. That statement is not true.
All shall be equal in terms of the law. That's still a pipe dream.
Currently, it's about the money. Can you afford to pay legal services?
When it comes to human rights, yes, on the document, the constitution, they are stated nicely there, but practically, and when it comes to implementation, those very same human rights favor the very same people that oppressed other people.
All the xenophobia going on is a symptom of the ANC and the government have not promoted good values according to the Charter and the Constitution adequately. The media, where would we be without media if we did not have a press in South Africa? My God, we'd be a hell of a lot worse. There's no doubt in my mind. We wouldn't know about Marikana, we wouldn't know about all sorts of things. Unfortunately, authority seems to be trying to clamp down.
Many are frustrated with the new democratic dispensation and are openly rebelling against it.
The demands of the Freedom Charter are still achievable. They're not so radical.
On paper, when you read the Constitution and the Freedom Charter and you hear about equal rights on paper, some of these things are there. But in terms of reality, people's lives changing, I don't think that's the case.
The Freedom Charter, you know, if we view it ideologically, it now belongs to the past.
We need to distinguish between the goals or destinations it set for South Africa, 1955, and the language that it used in 1955. I would have to observe that we live in a different world.
I would say we need a Freedom Charter, you know, of the present era.
It's a document which provoked debate within the trade union movement in the 1980s. There were those who saw it not as a socialist document. They saw it as some social democratic document with very limited demands.
I don't think the Freedom Charter has anything to contribute to solving the key problems of South Africa and specifically of the working class.
There are streets to be tarred. There are homes to be built. There are lavatories to be erected. There are sewers to be dug, lick pipes to be laid for running water, electricity to be brought. There are schools to build, hospitals, clinics.
The very same people who wrote that Freedom Charter, they then fulfilled their promises. I think they were lying to the people.
The kind of introspection we need will need a whole layer of fresh leadership combined with the elders who are still left in the organization to revisit the whole question of the Freedom Charter, what has happened since 1994.
Based on what the ANC has achieved, in fact not achieved in the past few years that the ANC has been in power, I do not have faith that they will realize the promises of the Freedom Charter.
They just wanted people to vote for them, to be in that position, so that they can look down to those people. As now they are up there and people are down, living in a dirty, wet tin house, no electricity, no water.
For a lot of people, they continue to feel like South Africa is not theirs because they just are completely excluded from day-to-day activities of the country in terms of unemployment, in terms of poverty.
They lied to the people. Washu Mandela, kubalandeli bakhe wathi
sohlangana ngefreedom. Thank you.
So fraught has the environment within the organization become that if the ANC does not experience a turnaround, it will not be able to construct that national democratic society that it aspires to.
We saw GEAR and what it did and the promises that GEAR made. Most of us were actually convinced that it's not going to do what it promised to do.
We have a problem with the neoliberal economic framework, which is largely about undermining any form of social welfare.
There are no proper policies, and we have stuck with neoliberalism and we have embraced it as a country. Nobody wanna see us together. Nobody wanna see us together. Nobody wanna see us together. Nobody wanna see us together.
Something serious has to happen in order to bring us back on track.
Now is the time to stand up and continue with the road towards economic freedom.
The EFF, the left NAMSA, I think generally these guys are asking all of the right questions.
I will say Nelson took us to a particular extent and then left it there for us to take it over.
They are a call to clarity, a call almost to soberness for an elite that in many ways has grown out of touch with the country that it seeks to lead.
Are we betraying the struggles of today, or are we going to be the new heroes of a new struggle for the total emancipation of South African people?
We must, as a movement, focus afresh on the task of building a non-racial country guided by the injunction of the Freedom Charter that South Africa belongs to all who live in it, black and white.
We slave and sweat, but we still remain poor. We build the houses, we build the flats, we build the dwellings, but thousands of us still remain homeless to this day. We even grow the food and harvest the crops and serve our big fat masters, yet our children and ourselves go hungry every day. In short, comrades, we produce the wealth of this country and create the profits upon which more and more capital is accumulated. Indeed, without us, the racist motto of exploitation can grind to a halt.
The question we should be asking is, what are we going to do to implement the charter? What are we going to do to enforce socialism in our society? Those are the questions, not the adoption of the charter. It's the implementation. It's to bring the charter to life. What we must be talking about, Comrade Chair, is action.
What we should be doing is to mobilize a revolutionary movement from the ground up.
And nothing short of a revolution is going to shift the trajectory we are in.
The second revolution has to take place, and God, I hope that it will be as peaceful as the first phase. We cannot continue like this.
As to whether the ANC is still capable of realizing and implementing the Freedom Charter, I think that boat has sailed already. It's time to think about new ways of organizing, and perhaps the old ways don't work anymore.